Welcome, welcome back to part two of Hanukkah 2020. Actually, this is Erev Hanukkah, and we are in the year 5781. We just read the Torah portion. Some people like to read Daniel 11, chapter 11, 25 to 35, and they actually liken it to, what really did happen historically, that the Jewish patriots freed Israel from the tyranny that they were under at the time, and especially with someone as Antiochus Epiphanes, who actually did a horrible abomination in the temple by sacrificing pigs on the altar. He really desecrated the temple. It had to be cleaned out. It had to be rededicated, the whole nine yards. And once they ran them out, and I'm gonna go on to the Brit Kaddishah, and we've got actually John. I'm gonna read from John chapter 9, 1 through 7, and then John chapter 10, 22 to 39. And I just want to add one other verse to this, and that is John. Chapter 8, verse 12. Yeshua spoke to them again, saying, "I am the light of the world. The one who follows me will no longer walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." So when we're talking, as I mentioned in part one of this, I'm talking about light overcoming darkness. Well, Yeshua is the light, and we are children of the light. So I'm going to go on to chapter 9 of John, verses 1 through 7. As Yeshua was passing by, he saw a man who had been blind since birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he should be born blind?" Yeshua answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. This happened so that the works of God might be brought to light in him." We're talking about miracles that at the time of Hanukkah, the miracle of the menorah, the light of the menorah burning for 8 days. Now we're talking about another miracle. This happened so that the works of God might be brought to light in him. We must do the work of the one who sent me so long as it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Having said these things, he spat on the ground, made mud with the saliva, and spread the mud on the blind man's eyes. He told him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which is translated sent. The pool of Siloam means sent. So he went away, washed, and came back seeing. And then we have John chapter 10, verses 22 to 39. Some despise the light and harden. Then came Hanukkah. It was winter in Jerusalem. Yeshua was walking in the temple around Solomon's colonnade. Then the Judean leaders surrounded him, saying, "How long will you hold us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us outright." Yeshua answered them, "I told you, but you don't believe. The works I do in my Father's name testify concerning me, but you don't believe, because you are not my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life. They will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." Again, the Judean leaders picked up stones to stone him. Yeshua answered them, "I've shown you many good works from the Father. For which of these are you going to stone me?" The Judean leaders answered, "We aren't stoning you for a good work, but for blasphemy. Though you are a man, you make yourself God." Yeshua answered them, "Isn't it written in your writings, 'I have said that you are gods'?" Little g gods, he's saying. If he called them gods, little g gods, to whom the word of God, big G, God, capital, came, and the scripture cannot be broken, do you say of him, the one the Father set apart and sent into the world, "You speak blasphemy because I said I am Ben Elohim"? If I don't do the works of my Father, don't believe me. But if I do, even if you don't trust me, trust the deeds. Then you may come to know and continue to understand that the Father is in me and I am in the Father. Therefore, they tried to capture him again, but he escaped from their hand. And I'm going to just finish this out. Again, he went back across the Jordan to the place where John first started immersing, and he stayed there. Many people came to him and were saying, John performed no sign, but all John said about this man was true. And many trusted in him there. So this is John 10, verses 22 to actually 43. And then that is the end of the scripture reading tonight. And I'm going to go on to talk a little bit more about Hanukkah and the festivities that go on. So every night for 8 nights, there is a candle that is added to the menorah. Like I said, I have an 8-branched. I have the Messianic menorah. So in the center, I have a shamash, which is also known as the attendant. It is also... It can also be thought to be symbolic of Yeshua lighting the other lights. Tonight we have the center candle, which is the shamash that is lit first, and that shamash will light the very first candle. And on the second night, we start with the shamash, then we light 2 candles, and we start from right to left, actually, as we're adding until the very last night. We have all eight candles are lit. Their special blessings are recited often to a traditional melody, or you can just recite them depending on what you're doing. Anyway, that's a little bit about the lighting of the candles, and that goes on. And I'm going to go into the blessings a little bit later. So this year we are beginning with Hanukkah tonight, of course at sundown, and it will be over on the 18th by sundown. So from the 10th to the 18th we have Hanukkah. Also, since Hanukkah is a miracle that involved oil, it's customary to eat foods fried in oil. And one of the things that is eaten is a potato latke. It looks like a pancake, and it's garnished with applesauce or sour cream. And also, there's a jelly-filled donut that is actually used, eaten, I should say. Sufganya. I'm probably not pronouncing that correctly. And there's a game that is also played during Hanukkah with a dreidel. It's a 4-sided spinning top bearing the Hebrew letters Nun, Gimel, He, and Shin, for an acronym of Nes Gadol Hayasham, a great miracle happened there. So the game's usually played for a pot of coins, nuts, or other stuff, which is won or lost based on which letter the dreidel lands on when it is spun. So there's a whole, it's a whole game that can be played. Now the story about the dreidel actually goes back to the time of the Maccabees as well. The Jewish children resorted to learning Torah in outlying areas and forests. It said that if a Greek patrol passed by, they would quickly pull out and play with small tops. And the dreidel games are saluted to the Jewish heroes of that time. The other thing is Hanukkah gelt, which is gifts of money to children. Also, this is a time of opportunity to give to charity. And then, of course, this is also the phenomenon of the chocolate gelt, the chocolate, the foil-covered money. If you've ever seen that, and what we can take out of this and the story of the Maccabees is never be afraid to stand up for what's right. And boy, do we see things in our own world today that we have to stand up against tyranny, and we have to stand up for what is right and true and godly. and Judah Maccabee and his band faced daunting odds, but that didn't stop them. And that's God's miracle that occurred. And God, with God, all things are possible. With a prayer on their lips and faith in their heart, they entered the battle of their lives and they won. So we can do the same in our world today and against evil, and let the lightness shine in every dark crevice of this planet and bring out, make the demons flee. We are the children of light. Yeshua is the light of the world to this day. And because of him, Yeshua, we have the authority to put to make the darkness flee in Jesus' name, in Yeshua's name. Always increase the matters of goodness and Torah observance. A single flame was good enough for yesterday, but today needs to be even better. A little light goes a long way. The Hanukkah candles are lit when dusk is falling. So it's at sunset. And Hanukkah teaches us to shine outwards to our surroundings with a godly glow of mitzvahs. And don't be afraid to be observant of God's commandments, and rather be like a menorah proudly proclaiming its radiance and be unique for all to see. Let that light shine. Now, we talk about that central lamp of the Hanukkah menorah called the Shamash, this, or also known as the servant. This bears the original flame that kindles all others. And when we think about that, we do think of Messiah. We do think of Yeshua, the salvations, wonders, and solace that God performed for us in those days at this time, therefore prefigure the greater deliverance that we have in Yeshua, the suffering servant and light of the world. Yeah, it's ironic that the only reference of the festival of Hanukkah occurs in the New Testament, not in the Tanakh. In the Gospel of John, we just read that that Yeshua, our Lord Yeshua, was at the temple during the feast of dedication, or Hanukkah. Now, at the time of the feast of Hanukkah took place at Jerusalem, it was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the colonnade of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." Now, that's also from the ESV. I was reading earlier from the Messianic Jewish Family Bible Tree of Life version. I kind of go back and forth. During a season of remembering miracles, also known as Nisim in Hebrew, Yeshua pointed out that the works that he did attested to his claim to be the long-awaited Mashiach of the Jewish people. His works and character clearly displayed the true light of who he was, and these works still shine to us today. Yeshua was and forever shall be the greatest Jew. He was a Jew who ever lived upon the earth, but the greatest being who ever was on the face of the earth. As Mashiach ben Joseph, our suffering servant, Yeshua is the ultimate Shamash. He is our light who enables us to shine a sacred fire of sacrificial love to the darkened outside world. Yeshua commanded, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." He told us that he is the light of the world and that whoever follows him will not have darkness but will have the light of life. "I am the light of the world. He who follows me does not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life." And Yeshua, our Messiah, gives us light, the very, very light of life. So that is important to know. We are called to be part of his temple, his body, and at this time we should reflect on rededicating ourselves to the eradication of all that compromises us and tempts us to assimilate with the hell-bound world around us. So we need to rededicate ourselves to God. Our body is a temple that houses the Holy Spirit. So we need to make sure that we keep our temple clean, and be careful, what you allow in. It is only by the light of Yeshua that we gain victory over the powers of darkness, since the darkness cannot comprehend the light. When we walk in the light, we have fellowship, unity with one another, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against such divinity sanctioned community. May the Lord God of Israel, the Father, the Blessed One, Yeshua, help us all to behold the glory of his light, abiding in his love. And may we turn to him now and rededicate our own lives as temples cleansed and readied by his Spirit to honor his abiding presence. This is why Hanukkah is so important to all believers, because this is a time of rededication. So if you're a Gentile Christian, don't miss this opportunity. Don't miss this opportunity. This is for you as well. It is in the new covenant. It is in the Brit Kadashah. It is for Jew and Gentile alike. So the question arises, should Christians celebrate Hanukkah? Well, as I just had expressed to you what it means and about the rededicating yourself, I don't see any reason why a Christian wouldn't want to celebrate Hanukkah as well. Because yes, we should be thinking about cleaning our temple and rededicating ourselves to the Lord. So there is nothing wrong with a Christian also celebrating, and certainly as Messianic Jew we do. So anyway, that is all I'm going to say about that for now. And I'm going to actually, before I end this part, I am going to, we're actually going to light the candle together. So we want to light the candle, the shamash, the middle candle. I'm going to read these blessings for you. So as we're lighting the first candle, we are going to say these blessings. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher kidashenu b'mitzvotav v'tzvinu nehalech ner shel Hanukkah. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, sovereign of all, who hallows us with mitzvah, commanding us to kindle the Hanukkah lights. And again, we are reading all the blessings tonight. So we're going to also read the Messianic blessing. Baruch ata Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher netan lanu shagim kagim hukot u'moadim lasimka lakavod Yeshua HaMashiach Adonai Adonu, I'm sorry, or Ha'alam. Got a little tongue tied there. Blessed art thou, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has given to us holidays, customs, and seasons for gladness, for the glory of the Lord Yeshua, our Messiah, the light of the world. And the second, and the third blessing, I should say, Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Ha'olam, Sheyash Nisim La Avoteno Bayamim Ahem Bazamem Hazay. Blessed art thou, Lord our God, Master of the universe, who performed miracles for our fathers in those days at this time. And we go with the Shehekienu blessing, Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Heolam Shehekienu Vikayam Vekeimano, Vegeyano, Lazman Hazay. Blessed art thou, Lord our God, Master of the universe, who has kept us alive and sustained us and has brought us to this special time of Hanukkah. And we kindle these lights to commemorate the miracles and wonders and saving acts that you have performed for our forefathers in those days at this time by your holy priests. And all throughout the 8 days of Hanukkah, these lights are holy, and we are not permitted to make use of them, but only to behold them in order to offer thanks and praise to your great name for your miracles, for your wonders and your salvation. And during the 8 days, we can also add the vowel hanisam. And we thank you for the miracles, for the redemption, for the mighty deeds, for the saving acts, and for the wonders which you have wrought for our ancestors in those days at this time. In the days of Medi-Yehu, the son of Jochanan the high priest, the Hasmonean, and his sons, when the wicked Hellenic government rose up against your people Israel to make them forget your Torah and violate the decrees of your will, but you, in your abounding mercy, stood by them in the time of their distress. You waged their battles, defended their rights, and avenged the wrong done to them. You delivered the mighty into the hands of the weak, and many into the hands of the few, the impure into the hands of the pure, the wicked into the hands of the righteous, and the wanton sinners into the hands of those who occupy themselves with your Torah. You made a great and holy name for yourself in your world, and effected a great deliverance and redemption for your people Israel to this very day. Then your children entered the shrine of your house, cleansed your temple, purified your sanctuary, kindled lights in your holy courtyards, and instituted these 8 days of Hanukkah to give thanks and praise to your great name. In Yeshua's mighty precious name, Amen and Amen. This spirit of Hanukkah agrees with other teachings of the New Testament. And the word Hanukkah itself means dedication, a word that shares the same root as the Hebrew word kinuch, meaning education. Just as the Maccabees fought and died for the stake of the Torah truth, so we must wage war within ourselves and break the stronghold of apathy and indifference that present world system that the world system engenders. We need to separate ourselves from the world. We must take time to educate ourselves by studying the Torah and the New Testament, for by so doing, we will be rededicated to the service of the truth and enabled to resist assimilation into a corrupt world. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. The cleansing of the temple is a matter of the heart, Shavarim. The enemy is apathy and the unbelief it induces. We are called to fight the good fight of faith and not to conform to this present age with its seductions and compromises. The Lord Yeshua gives us light, the very light of life. The light of the truth is the light of God's word. God gives us the victory through the spirit of truth, since it is the love of the truth that brings us to salvation. So this is something to always think about at this time. And yes, it is okay for Christians to celebrate Hanukkah along with Jewish people. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. And that's in Isaiah 60, verse 1. Well, that's just a little bit on Hanukkah that I wanted to share. And I'm going to end this with prayer, and then I'm going to come back with an altar call, because I always do every teaching with an altar call. Father God, we thank you for the ability to come together to learn about the importance of dedicating ourselves to you, the importance of being that light to a very dark world, and we are living in very dark times, and to not be afraid to stand up for what is right, just as in the Maccabees that we have seen the Maccabees and their band do to revolt against tyranny. We thank you, Lord, for showing us all of these things. And we thank you in the mighty name of Yeshua, Jesus. Amen and amen.